Ciao to all, and thank you to be here, and also thank you to Code Gen and to all the organizers to give me the possibility to be here this afternoon and to speak about this new feature that they are source generators that we have on .NET 5 and with the new release of C Sharp 9. Okay, so we can start, and okay, this is the hashtag. If you want to tweet something, okay, it's always a good thing. I am Andrea Ceroni. Okay, I'm a senior developer on Microsoft Technology Stack. I work in Helfo, a company that has one plant in Piacenza and another one in Fiorenzuola and also one in Kiev. And in Helfo, I'm a part of the R&D team. We mainly develop customized web management software for different customers. And we are also very proud for our 5-year-old community, KeyLab. And so if you are near Piacenza Parma and follow us on Meetup and also on Eventbrite, we have a new meeting during the next month. I don't know what else. I love mountains and also I love riding my MTB. Okay, so we can start with source generators. The idea is not new, okay, but it is always very fascinating because it has to do with automation. And when we think about automation, we think that maybe that means that we can work less, or in any case, at least avoid writing boring code. And it's good. Any dev has used some form of code generation, maybe in a more or less conscious way, maybe not with the generators we are talking about today, but with some other kind of generators. And this is true because different frameworks generate code automatically. Think, for example, for ResX files or the Razor pages or also the old ASP.NET web form. They all generate code automatically some way. Okay. And there are also some alternative tools that they act pre or post the compilation phase, like, for example, pre MS build or in a post compilation phase, like Fudi or PostSharp. And we briefly discuss this in a few minutes. With .NET 5 and C Sharp 9, okay, we have a new compiler feature that is so a Roslyn feature. And so we have an official way, an official Microsoft way to do something like this also. And we see that a generator is a .NET standard 2.0 assembly, okay? And so it works more or less everywhere. We have the maximum compatibility possible. Okay, so what is at the end? If you look at the definition on Microsoft site, it says that at the end it is a piece of code executed during the compilation. This code can inspect the program and produce additional code, which is put together with the original one. Okay, so seems quite easy. It's a new component at the end, and this time, as I said before, it is a compiler feature that allows us to do mainly two things. Okay, the first one is retrieve a compilation object that represents all the user's code that is compiled, and this object can be, so the compilation, this object can be inspected, and we can write code using all the metadata that we have at compile time. And the generated code works with the syntax and the semantic models of the initial code. In this aspect, a generator is very similar to an analyzer, for example, but with the difference that the source generator at the end emits code. Okay, and an analyzer just reports something about the code. And the other thing that we can do is that we are able to generate C# files that they can be added to the compilation during the course of the compilation itself. So in other words, it means that you can provide additional source code as input to a build while the code is being built. OK. If we just try to go a little bit deeper, okay, we can see that we have some C-sharp files, for example. We have the black box, that is the compiler, and at the end, we want to have some output that for example, a DLL file. And if we think about other tools, we already have the possibility to generate code. They work before or after the compilation phase. So for example, if you think at MS Build Task or CodeSmith, hold, quite old, but also Visual Studio itself can do it for different frameworks. We have some files on disk. These files are analyzed and the code is produced based on these. So for example, RESX files, ASP.NET Web Forms, or something like this. And at the end, you cannot distinguish the final code from the original one. So there is no way for the compiler to know, and we have no metadata at all. Another possibility is to act after the compilation phase. Okay, so there are very powerful tools like Fudi or PostSharp. Okay, Fudi is free, PostSharp is not. And these tools are weavers. So, okay, so at the end, they directly modify the IL code, the IL generated during the emit phase. They are very powerful, and we can modify the code produced by us for sure, but not only. Okay, we can potentially modify all the code that also is maybe referenced. Okay, if we forget about, I don't know, security and rights and permissions and something like this. Okay, now with C# 9 and with .NET 5 also, we have a third way, okay, which is to act directly inside the compilation. So inside, during the compilation phase, okay. With this new Roslyn feature, it is the first time that this feature is added directly at the compiler level. Okay, so something different than, for example, the T4 template that we have in Visual Studio. That is a Visual Studio feature, not a compiler one. Okay. And if we think about the compilation phase, we have three main steps. The first one is parse, okay? And during parse, the files are read and converted into the so-called syntax tree or concrete syntax tree. And they are a very faithful representation of every bit of our code. Syntax trees consist of nodes, tokens and trivia. So for example, also dots, spaces, and something like this. Okay, the next phase is compile. So when we have syntax trees, these syntax trees are sent to the compile phase and the product is the compilation. It is at this stage that all the information related to types, for example, are added, okay? For example, if I have an int variable, for the parser, int maybe it is a keyword, okay? But if I declare this variable as a int 32, for example, so like a type, for the parser, this variable does not know, okay, what is this? It is only at compile phase, okay, that the token is interpreted some way and with the correct type coming from the, I don't know, the base library, for example, okay? And so this is the second phase, and we have this object that is the compilation at the end. The third one is emit, and emit is where the IL is generated and then put into DLL, the final DLL, okay? So nothing at a very high level, this is what the compiler does. Okay, what happens if we put a source generator in between? Okay, essentially it means that we want to tell the compiler that there is a new actor in the pipeline, okay? And this actor it is useful at compile during the compile phase. So it means that we have the concrete syntax tree, okay, we have the compile phase, and when we are in this phase and we have the compilation with the concrete syntax tree, okay, it is sent to the generator, okay? And the generator can use them to generate code in turn. And what is generated at the end, it is a string of C-sharp code. And this can be arbitrarily complex. This string then retraces the phase of parse. And when it reaches the compile phase another time, okay, it is merged, literally merged, with the compilation in progress. And at the end, we have again the emit phase that produces the IL, okay, with the final result that is the DLL. So this means that we have a hook directly in the middle of the pipeline, okay, and it is very powerful. And at the end, it is also important to note that the generator code is not distributed. It is just a compile time thing. Okay. So some concepts. The first one is that the code generated by default, it's not saved on disk. Okay. It is just in memory. But if you wanted to inspect the generated code, you can using this attribute that is emit compiler generated files. Okay, it is an attribute that you have to specify inside the generator project file. And another important concept is, it is that there can be more than one generator inside the pipeline, but they are completely independent. Okay, this means that I cannot generate code by making decision starting from another generation, at least not now. Okay, the team is thinking about the possibility to have a sort of two-pass generation, but for now, this is the situation. Another important thing it is that a generator cannot modify existing code, okay, but only generate a new one. And if, okay, based on this assumption, you immediately eventually thought that, so it means that they are not useful because we have some other tools like Foodie or Postscript that they are maybe more powerful, then you will be probably change your mind, okay? Moreover, there is no need to go to do the same things that Foodie and PostShop, they already do very well. And okay, for this reason, we will see that the partial modifier is now more powerful than before. And we have a good integration with Visual Studio and also with JetBrains Rider. With Visual Studio starting from the version 16.8. And for sure, the integration is good from the point of view of those who use the source generator. Still a bit difficult during the development phase. This is mainly because Visual Studio is written in .NET full framework, and when it loads the source generator, then it can't easily unload it when the code change. Okay. Okay, we can see where they can be useful. For sure, okay, we have a performance boost by replacing reflection where we can, okay? It doesn't mean that starting from tomorrow you have to replace all the reflection code that you have in your project, okay? But we can do something, okay? For example, okay, it is very useful, they can be very useful in scenarios such as IOC containers or whenever we need to read the structure of a class, okay, to inspect the properties at runtime, for example, for some reason. And we will see an example in the demo. They are also useful to be able to maybe process files, okay, so files such as JSON or XML files. They can understand the structure of these files and create wrappers, okay? So create a sort of SDK to be able to work with this file and manage these files, This is true also because it is possible to pass additional file to the generator, specifying an attribute, okay, that is the additional file attribute inside the project file. Okay, another thing that is we want to avoid, okay, they allow us to avoid writing repetitive and boring code. So for example, if we look at the ORM mappings or value objects for some domain-driven design concepts or things like this, okay, they can be very useful to produce these files for us. They can also, as the analyzers, report errors or warnings during the compilation, okay? And to do this, we have to understand, okay, why now the partial modifier, it is much more powerful than before. Since the generators cannot modify code, one way to modify it is to have partial classes and methods, okay? So before C# 9, however, a partial method had several limitations. So it cannot return anything. It cannot have output parameters. It cannot also have access modifiers. Okay, potentially somewhere the implementation is defined, manually written or maybe generated. And if no implementation is found, the compiler simply deletes it. Okay, in C# 9, now all these things are possible. But you have to remember that if you use just one of them, the method defined as partial must have an implementation. Okay, it must have an implementation, also eventually generated. Okay. And this means that we can define a partial method. We define its signature, for example, and we can use it. And then a generator can provide the actual implementation of that method or for a class, for example. So you can see that it is very similar to the concept of changing the code, even though we are just adding some new code. Okay. Okay, let's see how we can reference a generator. So it can be referenced in two ways, okay? One is directly as a project, okay? So you can just like this, include a project reference, okay? So you have a generator project and you can include it. And if you choose this way, okay, you have to specify this output type item as analyzer. And this reference output assembly, okay, means that so this attribute stands to indicate that we are not actually referencing the generator code per se, but we are only interested in using it in the build phase to produce something, okay? Another possibility is to reference this generator as a DLL. Okay, with the appropriate analyzer tag another time. This means that, okay, if you can reference a generator as a DLL, okay, you can also produce as all the other normal .NET standard library, okay, also NuGet packages. Okay, so you can distribute your own generator using a NuGet package at the end. Okay, a generator must be a .NET Standard 2.0 library, okay? You can specify that the language is in version 9, and you have to reference at least, okay, these two packages, that they are Microsoft.CodeAnalysis.Analyzers and Microsoft.CodeAnalysis C# workspaces. Okay, about the implementation. Okay, when you create a generator, the class that represents this generator must be marked with the generator attribute, and it must implement the iSource generator interface. This interface defines two methods, initialize and execute. Okay. Initialize is useful if you want to register a so-called syntax receiver, and we will see what it is. Why you want to start a syntax receiver, okay, or register a syntax receiver. Because typically, if we want to generate code, okay, I don't know, maybe, for example, to replace reflection, it means that we want to do it as a consequence, for example, of something that already exists in the application code, okay? I don't know, for example, searching for a very specific attribute or a very specific method signature or I don't know, a very specific name of a class contained in some namespace, I don't know. And to be able to search for what we want to augment, for what we want to increase with the generation phase, we must read the syntax, okay, made of syntax trees, as we saw before, and we have the possibility to analyze these syntax trees in the generator, okay. And reading the syntax is so vital to understand where to look and how to find at the end what we want. And about this topic, Roslyn's APIs are very well documented. Actually, it's not hard to get lost because there are a lot of methods. And some tools like Syntax Visualizer for Visual Studio, they can help us, okay? Or there is another well-known application that is online, it is Sharp Lab, okay, to be able to understand and use the Roslyn API to understand the code and to understand the syntax trees produced starting from, I don't know, for example, a definition of a class or a definition of a method. Another way, very useful, is to use the Visual Studio Debugger, for sure, to be able to understand what happens during the generation phase. Okay, during the generation phase, okay, we have this object, it is a struct, and it is the generator execution context, okay? Inside this object, we have all the information that we need to be able to do what we want. So we have a list of the additional files that eventually we decide to pass to the generator. Okay, the cancellation token, it is because, we can cancel the generation eventually. We have the compilation, okay? So the object that represents the compilation that it is in place now. And we have the syntax receiver. And we have also the two methods that we want to use. One, it is a report diagnostic to be able to report something wrong during the generation, eventually, like the analyzers. And the last one, and also the very important one, it is the HUD source. That is the method that allows us to create, okay, and not to create, to add the newly created C# file, okay, to the compilation. At the end. Okay, so it's another important thing is reading symbols. The symbols represent the meaning of the code added during the compilation. And through the symbols, we can understand the types of the, we can, for example, understand the types, okay? It is one way, maybe also the only one way. So it means that we have some methods to be able to work with symbols, okay? We have, for example, this global namespace, okay, in the compilation object. It is the root namespace that contains everything needed for the compilation. So references, dependencies, and all other kinds of stuff. We have the method getTypeByMetadataName, okay? And this method, given the name of the type, returns the type itself. And so, for example, it's very useful when you search starting from attributes. We have the get semantic model, and it returns the set of symbols starting from the syntax. Okay, so for example, if I found the declaration of a method, I can understand using this method the type it returns, the type of the parameters of the method, and I don't know if or for a class, for example, it if the class has a public constructor, which are the arguments for this constructor, and so on. And the last one is this get symbol info. Once I have the semantic model, I can start fetching info about symbols. Okay, in this step, it is so when you are developing a generator, it is also very important to use the debugger, okay, with watches maybe, because for example, the get symbol, sorry, the get symbol info can return an I symbol, but this I symbol, in fact, can be an I don't know an I type symbol, an I namespace symbol, an I method symbol, or I don't know what. So, using the debugger, it is very important to really understand which is the type of the of these symbols at runtime. And okay, debugger maybe it's not easy. But there are several ways. Okay, at the end, one way is to just use the debugger.launch inside the generator code, inside the initialize method of the generator class. Another possibility, okay, maybe more user friendly, is that there is a class, this generator driver, okay, that you can use in a console application or also in a unit test project. And the generator driver, what it does is specifically designed to launch a generator. And this can be used okay, to be able to test the generator and to be able to see what the generator produces. Okay, that's it for with the slides. We can go with some demos, maybe. Sorry. Let's see some code. Okay, so I'm using Rider, okay, but you can for sure use Visual Studio, okay, and as I said, the generator at the end, it is just a .NET Standard 2.0 class library and nothing more than this. And if we look at the project file itself, okay, we can see that it references Microsoft Code Analysis and Microsoft Code Analysis Analyzers and also C# workspaces. And what I forgot to mention is that inside your generator, you can have some other dependencies. So, for example, I don't know, maybe inside your generator, you need, I don't know, Newtosoft JSON, okay? Or a system.txt.j or a .serializer, I don't remember the namespace. Or in this case, we will see that we use Scriban, okay? That is a very powerful package to be able to parse templates and generate, at the end, parse templates and, okay, substitute some variable inside the template. Okay, but let's start with, okay, so this is the generator project, and we see that, for example, we have here a very, very, very simple Hello World generator, and this generator, it implements the iSource generator, okay, with the initialize method that does nothing, and at the end, in the execute, what we want to do is, okay, create in this way, not so very beautiful in this way, but okay, it is one way to proceed. We can use the statement, okay, we can use the body, we can produce the body of a class. This class, it is this Hello World class. This class defines just one method, that is this say hello, Okay, and when we have the C sharp code, okay, as a string in this case, we can just add this new string to the compile, okay, to the compilation using the context.add source that we saw before. So it means that okay, if I go in another project, this console application, and I build the project, I already, in this case, it is already done, I can see the hello world generated, that is the name of the namespace, I can see the hello world class, and I can invoke the say hello method. And if I run my project, sorry, not this one, but this one. Okay, you can see the output. You can see hello world, hello from generated code. The following syntax trees exist in the compilation that created this program. Okay, it starts from the program CS, for example, and there is something else. Okay. Let's see something that maybe it is more useful. Okay, so try to imagine that I can also comment this out, but it's okay. Try to imagine that we have some classes like this one. Okay, what is this? It is just a Poco object that represents a result, maybe, of a query that we want to do to the database using, for example, Dapper. Okay, so try to imagine that we have a test DB, a test table inside the SQL, and we want a list, okay, of this test. And so it means that Dapper needs to, for example, query some way this table, and we want to map the result in a list of strongly typed object of type test in this case. And to be able to do this in a automatic way, let me say, we want to mark every Poco object like this with some attributes. Okay, so for example, we want to specify a data source attribute that at the end says from where we want to pull the data, and we want some property. We want another attribute, that is the column attribute. Okay, to be able to map eventually a property to a column inside the table. Okay. Why? Because this represents the type of the result of our query. But to be able to construct in a dynamic way the query that then we want to pass to Dapper, for example, we need something about this. Okay, so we need, let me say, generate another object, okay, that we can say it is this model metadata that contains some information starting from the attributes that we define here. So for example, okay, we need to say that to retrieve the data, our data source is the testDB, that the type of this data source, it is a view, for example, but it can be a table, it can be a stored procedure or a file query or I don't know what else. And for each property, okay, of this object, we want to have a sort of list of field metadata, okay, that maps the name of the property to the name of the column. And eventually, as in this case, if the name of the column is different, okay, we want to populate this property in the right way. And we can have some other objects like this. Okay, try to imagine one for each Dapper query for which you need a result that is maybe eventually strongly typed. So for LogsDB, for example, we have this error, and for users view, we have, for example, the email, the first name, the last name, and some other fields. Okay. Okay. If you you think at a possible way to achieve this result, okay, for sure we can say that we can use reflection. Okay, and it is true. And so it means that I can have something like this. So try to imagine that. Starting from a type, okay, and the type can be test or log or user, for example, I want to generate the model metadata. Okay, so I want to generate a class like this one commented with this information. Okay, so, okay, what I can do, it is for sure something like this. So I search for the data source attribute and okay, I start filling my model metadata. The name, it is the name of the attribute. The model type, it is the model type that I can specify inside the attribute as a second argument. So, for example, in this case, so I can parse the arguments of this attribute and use this information to populate the properties of the model metadata. And, okay, about, with the properties, I have to use reflection. For example, for each property, I can inspect the column attribute and okay, map the name of the property with the name of the column. And okay, that's it. Okay, the problem is that it is possible, sure, and we are used to do in this way. For sure, every time I query something, I do not want to call this code using reflection to be able to create the metadata. And so it means that maybe eventually I have to put in place a sort of cache. So I create a model for a type just one time, okay? And then I put this model in cache to be able to reuse it. But what I can do using a generator, it is that we can avoid to use reflection at all, and we can generate our metadata models at compile time, at not runtime. And so we don't need any cache at the end also. In which way we can do this? Okay, we can look at this data source generator, and this data source generator, it is another time, it is a generator that implements this iSource generator. And okay, as you can see, we define some code, okay, that represents the types that we need to model these things. So for example, we model an enum for the data source type, we model the data source attribute, we model also the column attribute with all the things that we need. We define the type model metadata and the field metadata. So it means that if we look back at our application here, data source, column, and all the other things that we use if we uncomment this code are generated using the generator, and they are fixed for now, okay? So we want to use these attributes to search inside the code to generate the model metadata for some, for a POCO object, for example. Okay, so in the initialize method, we register a syntax receiver, and what this syntax receiver does is, let's see here, define, okay, a list of candidate classes and candidate properties. At the end, it is very useful is candidate properties. In which way? Okay, because during the compilation phase, we also have the syntax trees of every everything that we maybe want. For each node, we want to see if this node contains the data source attribute. Okay, we just add this node to the candidate classes list, and the same thing happens for the candidate properties. Okay. Then, okay, so we just register the receiver. Then, okay, we start the execution of the generator. And the first thing that we want to do is we add to the compilation the types, okay, that we defined just above. So all these: data source type, data source attribute, column attribute, field metadata, and module metadata. Then, okay, what we want to do is, okay, inspect all, okay, the candidate classes, and, okay, maybe grouping all the properties that they are contained in these classes. But, okay, it's better, for example, to start from properties, okay, because when we search a property, we have the possibility to query about the containing type of that property. Okay, so we can search for all the properties of all the classes that they are mapped with the column attribute, and then we can group by the class type. Okay, for example. So starting from all the properties, okay, looking at the candidate properties that the receiver, okay, gives us, we can create the semantic model. We can get the symbol, we can search, okay, about the column attribute, and we have the list of all the properties of all the classes that they are marked with the column attribute. Now, it's easy to group all the properties by the containing type, and the containing type, it is the name of, it is the type of the class. And for each one, generate the model metadata. And generating model metadata, it is easy, okay, because we just have to find the data source attribute, take its arguments, that they are, I go back here, for example, the name of the table, okay, like this, and we want to construct an object like this, M metadata, with the model type, where the model type, it is the type of the class, the variable name, it is something that we want to use just in a few seconds to be able to define a variable for this metadata, model metadata object. And we have also the data source name, the data source type, and the list of the fields. Okay, using exactly the same the way to proceed as the data source attribute as the data source attribute. Okay, when we have this list of model, so we produce an object of type model metadata for each result type that we want as a POCO object, okay? So for test, we have the, I don't know, test model metadata. For log, we have the log model metadata, and so on for the other, okay? Now, we just have to generate a service. So generate a class that does exactly this, but without reflection, okay? And in which way we can do this? It's quite simple. Okay, we just have to go here. And if you look at this method, okay, you can, and it is commented, you can proceed using the string builders. And if you, I don't know, you want to have fun using string builders and okay, having fun with the impossible indentation to produce the code, you can. But another possibility is to just to use Scriban, as I said before, that is a template engine. Okay, it's not something that is related to the source generator. It is just something that says, okay, there is a template, and in that template, you want to put something starting from the generation. And so it means that I have a file like this, okay, that defines a template. And in this template, there are some placeholders that I want to fill. Okay, we will see this in a few seconds. Okay, starting from the template, I have just to parse the template, and I have to render the template using the information that I have inside my list of model metadata. At the end, okay, I produce an output. This output, it is the code of my model service, okay? And I just want to add this to the compilation. And so it means that I have a new class that is this model service.cs. If I build the application, this one, okay, you can see that if I look at program, I can, okay, now define a test class, and I have this model service complete, and I can query the metadata of this model service. And if I decide to debug this, I can see that for this end test, it contains, okay, the test DB as a data source, the data source type, it is of type view, and the tables, the fields, okay, they are target mapped, the column target mapped to the name, to the property target, and the env column mapped to the runtime. Okay, that they are the information, okay, provided here. If we look at the code that is generated from the generator, it is something like this. So let me open this one. Okay, this is the file generated by the generator, starting from the template. So it is a class, this model service, and this class defines some fields. Okay, how many fields? One for each POCO object that we have in our application. So it means that if I have test, log, and user, here I have a console app test, okay, and I decided to use lazy to be able to be, okay, maybe in this case it's more performant, and but you can also decide to put in a, to do in a different way. Okay, so I generate different lazy properties, different lazy fields, one for each model that I want to create, okay? And at the end, I just have to generate a method like this one, and this is very like the old get metadata that uses reflection. But because I have this property, these fields generated now, I can just simply switch, okay, starting from the type that I pass as an argument, and decide to return the correct one when, okay, based on the type that is passed as an input. Okay, and so I think that's more or less, and that's it. And inside the template, looking at the structure of this file, so looking at the structure of, it's quite big. Okay, looking at the structure of the model service generated, it is quite easy to understand the template. Okay, I have a list of metas, and I want to generate for each meta, I want to generate a lazy field, and this lazy field, it takes an action that constructs a new, okay, a new instance of a model metadata with the properties, okay, related to the type of the object that I want to generate. So test, log, or user, for example. And at the end, I just have to generate the get metadata method. Okay. And this get metadata method, okay, it is just a switch that need to return the correct field that is already defined here. Okay, so in this way, I can substitute reflection at all, for example, with an approach like this. But you can use the same approach to be able to create SDKs to parse XML or JSON files. You can use an approach like this to, I don't know, yes, substitute reflection somewhere where you need, and maybe the cases are many cases where you can do something like this. Okay, so that's more or less this. So I don't know if there are some questions, maybe yes, or maybe no, I don't know. We can try to wait eventually, otherwise, I think no, I cannot see something. Okay, I think there are no questions. So, okay, these are some links. Okay, you can find the GitHub, my GitHub repository on the first link. You can for sure inspect the official documentation about source code generators on GitHub, in the official Roslyn GitHub repository, Microsoft GitHub repository. In particular, this one, the source generator cookbook, is very, very, it's a guide, and it is very useful to try to think and, okay, provide so many examples where you can decide to use a source generator. And okay, the other links are some posts or some useful links that you can read about this topic. Okay, so
Andrea, aspetta, c'è una domanda. Prevedi nuovi ORM?
Sorry?
Una domanda, prevedi nuovi ORM?
Okay.
Sorry.
What do you mean about prevedi nuovi ORM? No, okay, if the question is maybe inside an ORM we can decide to use a source generator, yes, for sure, and I think they are already working on it. For example, in .NET, in AF Core maybe, and it's not like an ORM, but another important package that is Refit. I don't know, maybe you use it to call some HTTP endpoint. For example, the last version, okay, contains, it is completely rewritten using source generator to generate the stubs of the methods that map the HTTP calls. And so for sure, also ORMs can use this approach, okay, sooner or later. And maybe soon the ORMs that they are light ORM, for example, like Dapper or something like this. Okay. In this case, the example that I showed before is not strictly related to ORM. Dapper, it is just something that we want to use to create the query in dynamic way. But to be able to create the query, we need this model metadata that maps our result to something that it is useful to create the query. And to do this, okay, we can decide to do this at runtime using reflection, or, okay, using this approach, we can do it at compile time with a boost in performance for sure. Okay, something else? Marco, c'è qualcos'altro? Io non vedo nient'altro.
No, there are no other our question.
Okay, thank you. So thank you. Ciao. Ciao. See you next time.